Franchise isn't just the right of a man. You never saw. Yeah, 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 you never saw.
You know we don't want to take freedoms from you. Just want our rights and nothing less.
We cry for freedom.
Man, of course, is equal rights. Equal rights to have a job, to have respect, to not be viewed as a piece of meat. Equal rights to set forth our own humanity. Equal rights to get into graduate programs, to get into schools, to training programs. We're the bottom third of the employment in terms of pay. We represent, nonetheless, 34% of the workforce, yet we're the first to be laid off and the last to be hired. There aren't frivolous demands at all. We just want what men have had all these years.
Shattered dream, you cannot hide. Another contemporary economic myth is that women make 75 cents for every dollar men make because they're discriminated against in labor markets. Like other myths, this does have a kernel of truth to it. So for example, if you add up all the incomes of women and divide by the number of women in the labor force, and then do the same thing for men, what you'll find is on average, women do make about 75% of what men do. What's happening here is not discrimination in the labor market, but differences in the choices that men and women make about investing in their knowledge, their education, their skills, and their job experience that lead to them getting paid different salaries.
Were women educated in America, let's say, 19th centuries?
Well, absolutely. There's
really?
Sort of a common belief that that women weren't educated in the 19th century. But in fact, there were hundreds of institutions, not called colleges, called seminaries, called academies, called collegiate institutions, that provided a basic college-level education for women.
So at what point did America, at least, come to the realization that the mind had no sex, as the Enlightenment proclaimed? At what point did that happen?
Well, when the Enlightenment philosophies really came to this side of the Atlantic.
And is that around the Revolution?
Yeah, around that time. So the late 18th, early 19th century, the Enlightenment beliefs about the importance of reason and rational thought, and that that's what separated people from animals rather than men from women.
And I think there's also a perception that when women were educated, and even today there's this perception that, you know, they're educated in education, you know, to be better mothers. Is that a true perception, or is it not always that?
Well, yes and no. It depends on what has really changed is what type of education we think mothers need.
He doesn't believe rape victims exist. Yes, you heard me right. State Representative Bobby Franklin says he doesn't like the phrase rape victim. And if he has his way, they'd be called rape accusers. Are you kidding me, mister? You mean to tell me that our law should protect violent sex offenders like John Gardner and Philip Garrido more?
Let's time travel. Let's go back to the 1960s. What was in the air that made this such a unique time, and what was on the minds and lips of average Americans?
Well, I think, speaking for myself as an average person at the time, I assumed that you had to get married and you had to have children, otherwise you were a little crazy. So I kept saying, I'm definitely going to do that, just not right now. So if I thought that, I think it probably was the general idea that every person had to live a very similar life. What the women's movement and other social justice movements brought was the whole idea of uniqueness combined with community. But the you didn't have to play a role.
Now there is a growing body of evidence that bringing more women into the workplace, including into senior management, spurs innovation and productivity. Research also shows that companies that hire women executives and board members thrive and often outperform those that do not. One recent study, however, found that more than 70% of companies in emerging Asian economies have no women on their governing board. Now, by some estimates, by the World Bank and others, restrictions on women's economic participation are costing the APEC region more than $40 billion in lost GDP every year.
Species, but I sing no victim song. I am a woman, I am an artist, and I know where my voice belongs.
You'll remember that Representative Terry England, in debating this measure, the so-called fetal pain bill, compared pregnant women carrying stillborn fetuses to the cows and the pigs on his farm. Hell, we deliver stillborn fetuses from cows and pigs on our farm all the time. Why can't women do it? Let me quote him. If farmers have to, quote, deliver calves, dead or alive, then women carrying a dead fetus should have to carry it.
They cut out my sex, they bind my feet, silence my reflex, no tongue to speak. I work in the fields, I work in the stores, I set up the deals, and I'm off the phone. I am an endangered species, but I sing no songs. I am a woman, I am an artist, I know where my voice belongs. My body is fertile, I bring life about, drugs, seven and more, take them back out. My husband can beat me, his right, they say, and rape isn't rape. You say I like it.
With the HHS mandate now in effect, employee insurance plans across the nation must provide not only contraceptives, but also sterilization services. And as Sabrina Gladstone at CNS News points out, children in some states, even girls as young as 12, can now undergo permanent sterilization without parental consent. This means that girls who can't consent to sex and aren't even old enough to buy alcohol or drive will be able to obtain one of the most life-altering procedures imaginable without their parents even knowing.
You have an issue with both of this, correct?
Well, yes. Actually, the mandate imposes on all employer health plans the requirement of paying for and providing not only contraception and sterilization, but some drugs that many believe are abortion-causing drugs. Plan B, the morning-after pill, as well as Ella, which is known as the week-after pill.
Now, the problem with the information from both the Fox News anchor and his guest there is that none of the pills mentioned and none of the contraceptives covered actually cause abortions, according to the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, a group representing over 90% of American OBGYNs, including my wife, because all those birth control methods prevent pregnancy in one of the same three ways that ordinary birth control pills do: by preventing ovulation, by preventing normal movement of sperm and egg, and by preventing the implantation of a fertilized egg that begins a pregnancy. So arguing that any of those pills is an abortion pill would mean ordinary birth control pills are abortion pills, which is just not medically accurate.